गुड मॉर्निंग एवरी वन. सो इन दिस लेक्चर वी विल बी डिस्कसिंग अबाउट द अर्ली चाइल्डहुड केरीज. सो एट द एंड ऑफ द लेक्चर यू विल बी एबल टू डिफाइन अर्ली चाइल्डहुड केरीज, क्लासीफाई अर्ली चाइल्डहुड केरीज एंड डिस्क्राइब द इटियोलॉजिकल फैक्टर्स एंड क्लिनिकल फीचर्स कॉजिंग अर्ली चाइल्डहुड केरीज. सो इन दिस लेक्चर वी विल बी डिस्कसिंग अबाउट द डेफिनेशन एंड द क्लासिफिकेशन एंड अलॉन्ग विद दैट द इटियोलॉजिकल फैक्टर्स. So coming to the presentation outline that we'll be doing today, we'll have an introduction, which will be a very small introduction about the early childhood caries, classification of ECC, then etiological factors regarding the cause of early childhood caries, and the clinical features that we see in early childhood caries. So what is dental caries? Before we discuss about early childhood caries, what is dental caries? It's a microbial disease of the calcified tissue of the teeth, characterized by demineralization of the calcified tissue and destruction of the organic substance of the tooth, which often leads to cavitation. So dental caries is nothing but it's a microbial disease of the calcified tissue, that is our teeth, and which causes demineralization of the tissues, that is the calcified tissue, and destruction of the organic matter. And once the organic matter is destroyed, that leads to cavitation of the tooth and hence the formation of the dental caries. So dental caries is an epidemic disease which affects 100% of the population. So it is classified according to the age as early childhood caries, adolescent caries or senile caries. So early childhood caries is seen in children very early in the children, then adolescent in that age, adolescent age group, and senile is in patients who are old patients. And we have different synonyms for early childhood caries, which we'll be discussing for in the further slides. So as you can see in this picture, there are two pictures which one is reversible and the other is irreversible. So basically from the picture we can determine what treatment plans we can do, and depending upon the classification or is it reversible or irreversible, we'll be able to do the treatment plan also. So in the first picture that you see, it's reversible. Why? Because if you notice the picture, there is no cavitation that you see, only some amount of demineralization that has happened. So the enamel structure is still intact, but demineralization has happened. So how can you remineralize the demineralized structure? By using fluoride. While in the second picture, what you see is the irreversible type of damage that has occurred because of dental caries. There is cavitation that has happened, and in few of them it is extensive amount of cavitation that has happened. So some it might be even reaching the pulp or close to the pulp. So according to these two pictures, the one is reversible, which can be reversed because it is there is no cavitation that has occurred. And what is the most easiest or the most convenient use material that is used for remineralization of the tooth structure is fluoride. So fluoride in the form of topical fluoride, which can be applied on the tooth structure, that remineralizes the tooth structure. Or in the second case, you have to do some amount of restoration in all the tooth that you see, because there has been cavitation that has occurred. So moving on to the current concept and etiology of caries. So this you might have all discussed or learnt about it in your oral pathology classes. So the concept that we'll be discussing, this Keyes triad is in 1960 is an old one. So basically now we have a newer one, which is a tetrad, which was in the year 1963. So we'll first discuss about the old concept, and then we move on to the new concept, which is the tetrad concept. So dental caries is a multifactorial infection. As you can see here, it is either caused because of the cariogenic the presence of the cariogenic bacteria, the carbohydrates that is from the diet, and the tooth structure causes the caries. So all these together are responsible for the formation of caries. But with time, what happened, there is some amount of changes that occurred in this the etiology of caries, and which we'll be discussing in the next slide. So it was the Keys 1960 etiology of caries was further modified along with Keys and Jordan in the year 1963, in which they have included as time as one of the factors for the causation of dental caries. So the primary modifying factors included is the tooth anatomy, the saliva, the biofilm, pH, use of fluoride, any dentifrices or any oral hygiene measures, immune system, genetic factors. These are few of the modifying factors for the formation of dental caries. So if a patient has fissures which are not very deep, then again that is one of the positive factor, that less chances of occurrence of caries. The saliva, the buffering capacity, the oral clearance, the use of fluoride in the form of food and drinks and other supplements, along with the oral hygiene measures that the patient uses, this again modifies the factors for the occurrence of caries. The secondary modifying factors are the socioeconomic status, education, lifestyle, environment, age, ethnic group, occupation. These are also some of the secondary modifying factors for the development of caries. So we'll be discussing about the caries balance, how caries is avoided in some patients or how it can be prevented. So there has to be a balance between the protective factors and the pathological factors. So the pathological factors are the one which are the cause which causes caries or initiates the progress of caries formation, while the protective factors are the one which causes the remineralization of the tooth structure. So we'll be discussing about both the factors. So the pathological factors are the demineralization factors, are the factors that causes demineralization of the tooth structure and hence caries, are the acid producing bacteria. So these acid producing bacteria are from the food intake that we do. Once we they along with the food, the bacteria which is present in the oral cavity are the ones which causes the pH drop in the pH. So this drop in pH will cause demineralization. Then subnormal flow of saliva or the function of saliva. So if the salivary clearance or the oral clearance is slow, that again is one of the factors that is responsible for the formation of dental caries. Then frequent eating or drinking of the fermentable carbohydrates. So frequent eating or drinking, like if a child continuously, if the frequency of eating and drinking is a lot more than 5 to 6 times in a day, then his pH drop will be multiple times. So this will cause the demineralization of the tooth structure. And even if the patient has poor oral hygiene, there will be some amount of plaque in the oral cavity along with the food, the bacteria, increase in bacteria, that will cause the demineralization of the tooth structure. Moving on to the protective factors. So the protective factors that we know is the saliva flow, as I have told, that if the saliva clearance or the oral clearance is good, then that again acts as a protective factor. And even the saliva has few of the components which are acting as the protective factors. The remineralization products like the fluoride, calcium and phosphate, these are the protective factors that can be obtained. Fluoride from the toothpaste or the or from food and diet that we consume, then calcium from milk and phosphate, all these causes some amount of causes remineralization and hence act as a protective factor. The antibacterials like fluoride, chlorhexidine, xylitol from the chewing gums, chlorhexidine from the mouth rinses, these again are the antibacterials. So these reduces the bacterial count in the oral cavity. and a good oral hygiene again reduces the bacteria in the oral cavity and hence causes the remineralization and hence no caries. So in our normal mouth we have both the factors which are present. It causes both remineralization and demineralization, but the imbalance between the remineralization and demineralization causes the caries. If the demineralization is more, then that leads to caries, and if the remineralization is more, then that avoids the formation of caries. Here, as you can see, that demineralization or remineralization. So demineralization, that is if bacteria along with the fermentable carbohydrates that are present, fermentable carbohydrates from the food and bacteria which is present in the oral cavity, that causes demineralization and hence tooth decay. And calcium, phosphate and fluoride, which is from the saliva, the fluoride is from your toothpaste, all these causes the remineralization, hence tooth repair. So the caries imbalance which I have discussed earlier, this is a form of how we picturize form of the explanation. So we will be discussing about the critical pH. So what is the critical pH? We all know the critical pH being 5.5, and if the below 5.5, if the pH goes below 5.5, that is when the demineralization starts. And how does demineralization start? Because the pH is below 5.5, so more acidic environment, and hence this leads to the demineralization of the tooth structure, and at the end product will be cavitation of the tooth. So in the first diagram, if you see the green line which you see is the caries free group. So this was basically an experiment in which the people were given mouth rinses to rinse minutes after a glucose rinse, how it was seen. So in a caries free individual, the pH was seen to be at 5.5. So the dip what you see is at 5.5, and then the pH rises. So it's becoming, basically the pH is becoming alkaline. Well, a patient or a person who has slight caries activity, the pH will drop below 5, and hence these people will have slightly acidic environment in the oral cavity. The people with extreme caries activity, in which the pH will be below 5 for a longer time, and these are the people in which the oral cavity will have the acidic environment for a longer time. And in the next graph, what we see is the effect of frequency of ingestion of sugary foods on caries activity. So if a person takes three meals in a day, so his pH will drop below 5.5 at 3 times in a day. While a person who eats between meals sugars, his pH will drop, if you see in the second flow chart, his pH drop will be continuously below 4.5 for a longer time. So basically his oral environment is below 5.5 or in the acidic environment for a longer time. So this will again cause the dental caries. So one of the important factor is the frequency of food ingestion. So if the food is taken 3 meals or 4 meals in a day, the pH drop will be only for 3 to 4 times in a day, in which the oral environment will become acidic, and after 20 minutes it will be back to normal, its normal pH. But if the person eats sugars between 2 meals, between all the meals, then his pH will be below 5.5 multiple times, and this will cause his pH or the oral environment to be acidic for a longer time and hence more amount of demineralization and dental caries. So moving on to the early childhood caries, according to AAPD, that is American Academy of Pediatric Dentistry 2016, ECC has been defined as the presence of one or more decayed, non-cavitated or cavitated lesions. So this decayed, which may be cavitated or non-cavitated, missing, which is due to caries but not due to exfoliation, or filled tooth surfaces in any primary tooth in a child under the age of 6 years. So this definition of given by AAPD is very, very important for both ECC and severe ECC. So ECC is defined as the presence of one or more decayed teeth, which may be because of cavitated or non-cavitated, missing due to caries, or filled tooth surfaces in any primary teeth of a child under the age of 6 years. While severe early childhood caries is a sign or any sign of smooth surface caries in a child younger than 3 years of age, or from ages 3 through 5, one or more DMF smooth surfaces in the primary maxillary anterior teeth, or a DMF of more or equal to 4 in a 3 years old child, 5 in a 4 years old child, and 6 in a 5 years old child. So severe early childhood caries is any smooth surface caries which is seen in a child younger than 3 years of age. Or a simpler definition is, if the child has a DMFS of more than or equal to 4 in age 3, 5 in age 4, or 6 in age 5. So the early childhood caries, as I have told, that it has various synonyms, which is nursing caries, nursing bottle mouth, nursing bottle caries, baby bottle tooth decay, nursing bottle syndrome, milk bottle syndrome, and etc. We still have some more synonyms for the early childhood caries. So moving on to the consequences of early childhood caries, there's higher risk of new caries lesions in the both primary and the permanent dentition. So the consequence of early childhood caries is there are more chances of occurrence of new caries lesions in both the primary and the permanent dentitions, and there is hospitalization in emergency room visit due to the pain, infection and abscesses. So due to the early childhood caries or ECC, what will happen, there is more amount of hospitalization because the child will be uncooperative to get the treatment done and has to be hospitalized for the treatment, emergency room visits because of the pain and infection, and the abscess will cause severe pain and emergency room visits. There are high treatment costs under general anesthesia or sedation. Pain, infection, abscess, chewing difficulty, malnutrition, gastrointestinal disorders, and low self-esteem. So pain, infection, abscess. This the infection and the abscess will cause pain. The patient will have chewing difficulty because of the pain and the abscess and infection. Malnutrition because the patient is unable to consume anything, gastrointestinal disturbances, and low self-esteem because of the caries occurrence, especially in the anterior teeth. They will have low self-esteem to even smile or talk showing the teeth. ECC may also cause retarded growth, which may lead to malocclusions and poor speech articulation. So retarded growth is because of the diet, reduced amount of food intake will lead to retarded growth, and it also leads to malocclusion because there will be loss of the arch length and arch width, which leads to malocclusion, and this malocclusion is because of the larger or permanent dentition, permanent teeth, which to accommodate the larger permanent teeth, there will be no space and hence leads to malocclusion and poor speech articulation because of the absence of the anterior teeth. There will be loss of school days because of the infection, inflammation, pain, diminished ability to learn, and diminished oral health related quality of life. So these are the few consequences of the early childhood caries that we see. Moving on to the microbiology of early childhood caries. So as we know, when the child is born, the mouth of a newborn is free of microorganism, but the child attains these microorganism once once the teeth erupts into the oral cavity. So whether the child is by cesarean or natural birth, that the child will be free of all microorganism. The mouth is only colonized by the bacteria once the tooth erupts. So the bacteria needs a hard surface to hold on to the tooth surface or hold on into the mouth, and for the bacteria to be there on the oral cavity, it needs a hard surface. So this hard surface is the tooth. So once the tooth erupts, the microorganism gets colonized. So the bacteria that are present are S. salivarius, that is Streptococcus salivarius, which becomes established within a day of birth. So once after birth, the first bacteria that are present into the oral cavity is S. salivarius. Then you have the S. sanguis, that is Streptococcus sanguis, is established within a year of eruption of the teeth. Then you have the S. mutans, which is the gradual increase with age, beginning with none in infants to 46 in children, with primary dentition to adults in 90% in the adults. So once the child is born, the first bacteria that are present after birth in the oral cavity is the S. salivarius, which is there. But these the new other bacteria that come, that is the S. sanguis, once within a year of eruption of the teeth, while the S. mutans, which is the causative microorganism for dental caries, increases with age, beginning initially there is zero in infants to 46% increase in children with primary dentition, and in adults you find 90%. So with age, the S. mutans increases. So the microbial risk markers for early childhood caries is MS, that is mutant streptococcus, and lactobacillus species. So these are the two bacteria or the microorganism are the ones which causes the early childhood caries. One is the mutant streptococcus and lactobacillus species. The complexity of the oral microbiome and other bacterial species. So the MS, mutant streptococcus, are transmitted vertically from the caregiver to the child through the salivary contact affected by the frequency and amount of exposure. So the transmission from the child, as we know, the child will initially have no microorganism, but this mutant streptococcus are transmitted from the caregiver, basically being the mother. It's transferred to the child through the salivary contact. So salivary contact may be like a kiss, or mother giving a kiss to the child, or sharing the food, and it is also affected by the frequency and amount of exposure. So if the mother has high mutant streptococcus count, the child will also have a higher amount of MS counts. It also depends upon the amount of exposure. So as I've told, infants whose mothers have a high level of mutant streptococcus, a result of untreated caries, are at a greater risk of acquiring the organism earlier than the children whose mother have low levels. So if a mother has high levels of mutant streptococcus and the mother has not undergone any treatment or caries treatment, so there are chances that the child will acquire these mutant streptococcus earlier than a child whose mother has low level of mutant streptococcus. So horizontal transmission is example between the other members of a family or children in a daycare also occurs. So other members, especially when they are feeding or playing with them, or children in the daycare when they are sharing food with the other children. Now moving on to the diet and early childhood caries. Diet is one of the important factor that plays for the development, that plays an important role in the development of the early childhood caries. So as you know that acid production in bacteria, so we'll be discussing how the acid production occurs because of the consumption of the food. So basically what happens, sugar, as you know, that is glucose or galactose, that is the dietary sugars, that is diffused rapidly into the plaque which is there into the oral cavity on the tooth surface, and are fermented to the lactic acid or other acid which can be stored into the intercellular polysaccharides of by the bacteria, prolonging the fall in the pH. So the pH of the oral cavity is below 5.5 and promoting a suitable environment for other aciduric and acid forming bacteria. So this sucrose is unique because it is the substrate for production of the extracellular polysaccharides, and sucrose favors the colonization by oral microorganism, and they increase the stickiness of the plaque, which allows it to adhere in the larger quantities on the tooth surface. So this is how the diet and ECC is correlated. It's based on the amount of acid production. There's an associated risk factors to the microbial etiology, which is high consumption of sugars, which I've already told that higher consumption of sugars will cause the acid production and hence for a prolonged duration. So the caries conducive dietary practices appear to be established by 12 months of age and are maintained throughout early childhood. So any caries producing practices, conducive caries forming practices, which are established by 12 months of age, this is maintained throughout early childhood. So the frequent nighttime bottle feeding with milk and breastfeeding is also associated in ECC. So the frequent nighttime bottle feeding with milk and other added sugars is one of the causative factors for the development of early childhood caries. This occurs because when the child feeds in the bottle feeding is done in the night, there will be some amount of pooling of saliva and pooling of the milk along with saliva. So the tooth is in contact with the sugared milk for a longer time, so more acidic environment, and since it is more acidic, this will cause more amount of demineralization. So nighttime bottle feeding with juice, repeated use of a sippy or a no spill cup, and frequent in between meal consumption of the sugar added snacks or drinks increases the risk of caries formation. Any stagnation of the milk or juice in both the mouth or around the neck of the anterior teeth, and fermentation of the saccharides, that is the lactose and the sucrose, which is found in the milk and juice, which contribute to the caries process. So the nighttime bottle feeding along with any juice or juice with added sugars and frequent consumption will increase the risk of caries, and stagnation of milk in the mouth for a longer time, this which comes in contact with the neck of the anterior teeth, and this contributes to the caries process. So while ECC may not arise from the breast milk alone, breastfeeding in combination with other carbohydrates has been found in vitro to be highly cariogenic. So it is not only that breastfeeding alone causes the early childhood caries. Breastfeeding along with other dietary habits has been found to be in vitro, and this again has been highly cariogenic. Any frequent consumption of in-between meals, snacks and beverages containing sugars increases the risk of caries due to prolonged contact between the sugars in the consumed food or liquids and cariogenic bacteria in the susceptible teeth. So this frequent consumption of meals or snacks, snacks between the meals or beverages which contain sugars increases the risk of caries process. According to the American Academy of Pediatrics, has recommended that infants should not be given juice from bottles or covered cups that allow them to consume the juice throughout the day, and the intake of 100% juice should be limited to no more than 4 to 6 ounces per day for children 1 through 6 years old. So the AAP has recommended that the child should not be given any type of juice or drinks in the bottles, so that they consume, and the child consumes the juice throughout the day. It should be given in cups, and the intake of 100% juice should be only limited to 4 to 6 ounces per day for a child from 1 to 6 years of age. And newly erupted teeth, because of the immature enamel and teeth with enamel hypoplasia may be at a higher risk of developing caries. So especially teeth with newly erupted teeth, and because these newly erupted teeth have immature enamel, and the teeth with enamel hypoplasia have a greater risk of developing dental caries. Moving on to the tooth and early childhood caries, immature post-eruptive enamel is the post-eruptive enamel after the eruption, the enamel is immature, so they are more susceptible to the development of caries. Hypomineralization or hypoplasia of the teeth increases the susceptibility of the child to caries. If the child has a thin enamel, which is seen in primary teeth, is one of the reason why we have early childhood early spread of the lesion. So in primary teeth, the spread of caries is early and faster because of the thin enamel in primary teeth. The developmental grooves also play important factor in the retention of plaque and hence the development of caries. Saliva, decreased salivary flow during sleep and reduces the buffering capacity of saliva, thereby increasing the tooth susceptibility to caries. So when a child is sleeping or during sleeping, what happens, there is a reduction in the flow of saliva, and this makes the tooth and the oral clearance is reduced. So this increases the susceptibility to caries. Improper oral hygiene measures and incorrect use of fluoride and improper brushing again causes the dental caries. So it is an important factor that determines the caries activity. More the time the child sleeps with the bottle in the mouth, there is higher risk of developing caries. So during sleep, what happens, the flow of saliva is diminished or reduced, and swallowing reflex is also absent. So once the child consumes milk, the milk from the oral cavity cannot be eliminated. So it will be there in the oral cavity for a longer time and it pools around the surfaces of the teeth, providing more time to the bacteria, that is Streptococcus mutans, to metabolize the carbohydrates to produce acid, which leads to the acid production. So the other factors of early childhood caries are low or moderately low parental socioeconomic status. So if the parents have a low socioeconomic status, they will have reduced amount of information regarding the good oral hygiene. So this is one of the factors of the early childhood caries. Unemployment, single parenting, overindulgence of parents will again are a few of the risk factors of ECC. Low educational or intellectual levels, the number of siblings or crowded homes, handicapped or mentally retarded children or sick are risk factors attributed to chronic illnesses in which the child will be consuming syrups used for therapeutic purpose at bedtime. So a child who is handicapped or mentally retarded will have reduced efficiency of cleaning his oral cavity, and hence will be a risk for development of caries. And these children will be on medication for a long time. So syrups can be used for them, or syrups are used for therapeutic purpose at bedtime. So this again, consumption of syrups at bedtime will be one of the risk factor for the development of dental caries. So the low birth weight infants, so a child who is less than 2500 grams is on a risk of development of dental caries. Moving on to the clinical features of early childhood caries. So nursing bottle caries, the intraoral decay pattern of nursing caries is characteristics and pathognomic of the condition. So in nursing bottle caries, you have very specific features, that is there will be caries which is present on the anterior teeth, not on the mandibular maxillary anterior teeth you see, but not on the mandibular anterior teeth. There will be caries also on the posterior maxillary and mandibular. So it affects the primary teeth in the following sequence of involvement. So the maxillary central incisors are the one which are most commonly involved, the facial lingual proximal surfaces, then you have the maxillary lateral incisors, again the facial lingual proximal surfaces, then you have the maxillary first molars, the facial lingual occlusal and proximal surfaces, maxillary canine and second molars, and then you have the mandibular molars. So the most common are the maxillary central incisors, maxillary lateral incisors, maxillary molar, maxillary canines and second molar, and last is the mandibular molars. So mandibular teeth are least affected because of the presence of the tongue which covers the mandibular teeth, and there is no pooling of the milk in the mandibular region. So the typical characteristics of nursing caries is you have white spots which are seen. The initial stage you have see white spots along the gingival margin. There is rapid development which progresses within 6 months from the enamel to dentine. So the progress is very fast. That is in 6 months they extend from enamel to dentine. The maxillary incisors are affected first, and next affected are the maxillary, primary and mandibular molars. So when the disease becomes severe and untreated, mandibular molars are also involved. So if the treatment is not done or untreated, the last teeth that caries is involved is the mandibular molars, which are also involved. So the mandibular anterior teeth, which I've discussed, why they are usually spared because of the protection by the tongue, and also because the cleansing action of the saliva due to the presence of the orifice of the duct of the sublingual gland, which is very close to the lower incisors. So the two most important factors why the mandibular anterior teeth are spared, because of one is the tongue, and the second is because of the cleansing action of the saliva because of the presence of the sublingual gland. And this unique pattern and unequal severity of the lesion is due to the chronology of primary tooth eruption. So that the sequence of eruption is also plays an important role in the pattern and severity of the lesion. The duration of the deleterious habits of feeding and the muscular pattern of infant sucking. So these are one of the few unique patterns and unequal severity of lesions. So sweetened dummy, comforter or pacifier caries. So in which there is destruction which is extensive that you see. This is all because of the dummy sucking or the comforter or pacifier sucking. Which is involving all the teeth including the second primary molars and canines because of the large soft dummy bulb which extends with its sticky coating even over the occlusal surface of the molars. So if a child is sucking on pacifiers or sweetened dummy, it will be extensive and involve all the teeth because it is the first important thing is that the pacifier will be large, soft, and it will be coated with a sticky coating, and it will always extend onto the occlusal surface of the molars. The maxillary incisors show decalcification and yellow discoloration almost immediately on eruption. The process rapidly spreads to the first primary molar as the dummy habit. Often continues beyond the age of 2 to 3 and total crown destruction is also common which is seen. So the rapid progress of the lesion is due to the presence of the streptococcus mutans and the constant supply of the fermentable carbohydrates. So the rapid progress of the lesion is because of the streptococcus mutans and the constant supply of the fermentable carbohydrates. Next we have the breastfeeding caries. So excessive frequent breastfeeding of babies and infants may also lead to dental caries. So caries in at will breastfeeding. Children usually is seen as a rough. In this type the children usually have a rough incisal notch which is situated in the mid incisal region of the maxillary central incisors. So on examination of the palatal surface, a complete destruction of the palatal enamel surface which is seen. So on examination, what do you see? You see a palatal surface with complete destruction of the palatal enamel, and this is because of the small size of the human nipple, and this nipple lies on the palatal vault and does not spread against the molars as compared to seen in bottle feeding nipples. So that is the reason there is only slight amount of roughening on the incisal edge or the mid incisal region of the maxillary central incisors. So the multifactorial reason for early childhood caries. So the influence of host microbe, diet, the influence of the host, the microbe diet interactions in the etiology of and in pathogenesis of the early childhood caries. So diet, which may be high sugar diet, feeding practices, and the nocturnal breastfeeding, feeding practices, that is if the frequency is more. So this leads to early childhood caries along with the microorganism, which is the maternal oral health. If the mother have high caries index, the child will also have high caries index because of the transfer of the microorganism from the mother to the child. Oral hygiene also plays an important role. Good oral hygiene reduces amount of caries caries incidence. And the saliva, if the saliva clearance and has a good buffering capacity, there will be reduced amount of caries. The environmental factors is if premature birth or low birth weights, poor parental education, low socioeconomic status, which again leads to early childhood caries. And the teeth, like enamel, if there's an enamel defects, genetic factor, and lack of fluoride exposure. Enamel defects, if the enamel is thin or hypoplastic or hypomineralized. Genetic factors are also important, and the lack of fluoride exposure. All these factors leads to early childhood caries. So moving on to the rampant caries. So what is rampant caries? It's defined as a suddenly appearing, widespread, rapidly burrowing type of caries resulting in the early involvement of the pulp. So this is suddenly appears, and which has widespread and burrowing type of caries, and it has early involvement of the pulp. The characteristic feature is the proximal surface of the lower anteriors and the development of cervical caries, while that of the early childhood caries, you have the involvement of the maxillary anterior teeth, while in rampant caries you have the lower anterior teeth are the one which are involved, and the labial surface of the upper anterior teeth. In this picture, you will be seeing the progression of early childhood caries. So the first is A, that is a normal teeth, but once if the diet of the child and the oral hygiene measures, the of all the factors play important role, then the early childhood caries, as you can see, the B picture is, it's a non-cavitated smooth surface caries. So it is non-cavitated caries lesion which we see. C is a cavitated caries lesion. D, again the involvement of the upper anterior teeth, especially the maxillary anteriors, central incisors, lateral incisors, and the canines on the labial surface, and involving the proximal surfaces also. This leads to further the caries progresses and involves the pulp, and as you can see in the picture E, that is, there is also pulpal involvement because of the sinus opening which is present. The picture F, the crown breaks from the cervical area. And in G picture, what you can see, there is extensive involvement of the pulp. There is also sinus opening and pus discharge from the posterior teeth. And it is also started caries on the mandibular teeth also, as you can see in the canine region. So moving on to the stages, that is, stage 1 is the initial stage, in which there is cervical and interproximal opaque white chalky demineralization which is seen on the maxillary anterior teeth. So this is stage 1, which is the reversible stage, in which chalky white appearance you see, that is, in especially in the cervical or the interproximal region. This is because of the demineralization of the tooth structure. In this, the patient does not complain of pain or toothache due to the caries progress, and the dentist is the only one who can diagnose this by using the air syringe and thus drying the tooth properly. So once you dry the tooth with a three-way syringe, you can see the white, chalky white appearance. Stage 2 is the damage stage or the caries stage, in which the caries extends into the dentine and marked discoloration is seen. So in this stage 2, you have the irreversible damage, that is, the enamel structure is damaged and the caries progresses to the dentine, and discontinuity of the enamel surface is seen when penetration of the caries lesion occurs, and parents can now spot the decay, and the child may even start complaining of toothache on ingestion of the extremely cold food, examples ice cream. So in this stage, that is stage 2, where the enamel is damaged, the caries progress has reached the dentine, the patient might complain of pain or discomfort during ingestion of any cold food, and the parents can also spot the decay. In stage 3, there will be deep lesions. This stage is reached in 10 to 14 months from the initial start of the caries process. So a complaint of pain during the tooth brushing or eating, especially while biting, are frequent, and there will be also complaint of pain during the intake of hot or cold drinks, and diagnosis is facilitated if the patient complains of pain during the eating and brushing, and if the child uses the canines to incise the food. So the deep lesions are seen 10 to 14 months after the initial lesions, and the patient will complain of pain. The stage 4 is the traumatic stage, in which there will be fracture of the tooth structure of the caries tooth structure from the cervical area, and there will be frequent occurrence of root stumps that will be seen. So when a toddler learns to walk, and when his protective reflexes have not developed, and that is the time when they are trying to walk, they fall, and once they fall, they sometimes fracture the incisors, as they already have since they already have caries tooth, and once they fall, the tooth is already weakened, because the tooth may fracture, and sometimes even the parents don't notice. Now we have come to the end of the lecture. So in this lecture we have discussed about the introduction, the definition of early childhood caries, which is very important, the definition given by American Academy of Pediatric Dentistry for ECC and severe early childhood caries, the pathological factors and the protective factors for the development of dental caries, and in that we have discussed elaborately. So I will be putting up an assignment, and if there is any discussion that needs to be done, or if any clarification needs to be done, please feel free to contact. Thank you.